60, 70, até 90, a questão relacionada à política habitacional de baixa renda mostrou para nós que as ações do governo eram ações descontinuadas, não havia a participação comunitária na maioria dos programas, todos os projetos, depois de 4, 5 anos, estavam deteriorados, uma insatisfação muito grande por parte da população que abandonava essas áreas e que se sentia abandonada pelo próprio governo. Em 2007, o governo federal lançou o Programa de Aceleração do Crescimento, o PAC, em todo o país. O Rio de Janeiro foi contemplado com 15 diferentes cidades. As prioridades eram infraestrutura, urbanização de 5 grandes favelas, remediação e limpeza de 2 baías e construção de unidades habitacionais para a população de baixa renda. Inicialmente, se previa atender cerca de 2 milhões de pessoas, de famílias, e o valor inicial era de 2 bilhões de dólares. As áreas escolhidas eram áreas que tinham como característica principal serem formadas por população de baixa renda, falta de infraestrutura, um alto índice de desemprego e um alto índice de violência. Ou seja, não estamos falando em áreas piloto, em projetos pilotos e em favelas pequenas. Vale lembrar que o Rio de Janeiro tem cerca de 1.000 favelas em sua cidade. Em 2008, com o PAC já iniciando suas obras, foi determinado também pelo governo federal que, para além das obras, fosse implementado o trabalho social. Foram essas 5 favelas, Complexo do Alemão, Manguinhos, Rocinha, que são as 3 maiores favelas do Rio de Janeiro, além do Morro do Preventório e o Complexo do Pavão, Pavãozinho, em Copacabana. Estamos falando em cerca de 350 mil pessoas que eram o nosso trabalho, o foco do nosso trabalho. E o principal objetivo não era somente a transformação do território, mas era essa transformação em processos de desenvolvimento sustentável que trouxessem a geração e a transformação deste território através do crescimento econômico e da comunidade, da participação comunitária em todo o projeto. Diferentes ações integradas. A questão social, que caminharam juntos desde o primeiro momento, com métodos de participação. Ele foi desenvolvido em 3 grandes eixos. O censo foi o primeiro censo, que nós chamamos canteiro social, uma oficina social no território. Em cada comunidade, esse escritório local se tornou um ícone de confortável em nos visitar, em participar de reuniões, de principais áreas cujo trabalho foi desenvolvido. A área foi dividida em 2. Uma parte que o governo do estado atuou, que eu trabalhei como coordenadora, e uma parte em que a prefeitura, o município, atuou. O censo, como eu disse, que foi o primeiro realizado no país, contratou 1.450 moradores das comunidades para aplicação do questionário do censo. O censo foi residencial e empresarial. Hoje nós temos no site da EMOP todos os resultados do censo. Um aspecto importante foi que, a partir do censo, nós podemos desenhar, redesenhar a comunidade em si, o projeto da comunidade, todas as suas vielas, os seus becos, as suas ruas, e as pessoas passaram a ter acesso a essas informações. O Rio de Janeiro tem 22%, 78% de chegar ao mesmo patamar que a cidade do Rio de Janeiro tem. A questão da água encontrada na comunidade é um problema gravíssimo que traz também grandes ruas, cidades inteiras que foram realocadas. Mudam, porque nós vamos avançando com o processo em relação às famílias. Envolvida em Medellín, que eu fui visitar e conhecer, e que nós convidamos. A partir destes desenhos é que os arquitetos, engenheiros e projetistas fizemos vários projetos com a comunidade para a geração de renda relacionados à questão
de educação ambiental com a coleta de óleo. Criamos 60% de empregos, quase de 10 mil empregos, prêmios internacionais por esse projeto. Aqui algumas fotos das reuniões, das capacitações, de como era de cada casa. Aqui como...
We have the next speaker. Is actually Dr. B. Chandramohan from Indian Administrative Services, is presently the Secretary to the Revenue Department, Government of Tamil Nadu.
A population of about 7 million. It is a city which in the last 4 years was witness to a drought of 3 consecutive years, and in the 4th year, we had a flood, which was the worst in the last 100 years. I had this opportunity to be a part of this great effort to navigate the city and its water and sewerage services through these extremes of climate change. I intend in the next few minutes to share with you this journey of resilience personified by the people of Chennai. A small theoretical backdrop, why we need to sort of look at resilience. The basic needs of drinking water, sanitation, have emerged as the foundation for all developmental processes. Though they are largely taken for granted and mostly treated as given, in fact, to ensure normalcy, a lot of hard work, investments, and effort have to go into in the background so that the front end, the water, ultimately flows from the tap into your house. It is politically very sensitive, and today, why is it important? Climate change, we all now know, is an ongoing process. We can see and we can perhaps expect that there will be more droughts, there will be more floods, and unpredictable rainfall patterns playing havoc with our lives. These unpredictable patterns have dramatic and severe implications for the billions of people who already are accessing some kind of services, but this is going to be more severe to people who do not yet access piped water supply and sanitation. A brief overview of Chennai, South Indian city, teeming metropolis, about 7 million population, 3 years of successive drought, and in December 2015, we saw the floods, which were due to the highest rainfall in the last 100 years. However, the spirit of Chennai, the people of Chennai, is basically exemplified in this particular saying. A bird sitting on a tree is never afraid of the branch breaking, because her trust is not on the branch, but on her own wings. This is perhaps very apt for Chennai, because it is the inherent strength of people that gave us the resilience to face these two extremes of climate change. Chennai waters, though I have a larger perspective, but time does not permit and the topic specifically mentions about water, I will stick to water and sanitation, more so in water. Chennai has basically a multi-matrix of water sources. We get 16% of our water from desalination. We are the first city in the whole country to have desalination plants. Very important, we use wastewater, we recycle it after secondary treatment, and we use it for industries, that's about 10%. Most of our water is from surface sources, which is 65%. Groundwater accounts for about 9%. As I already mentioned to you, we had a 3-year continuous drought. A city of the size of Chennai does need to be given water day on day without any compromise, and we were giving 830 MLD of water. Suddenly, these 3 years, we found that the reservoirs ran dry. We were having water tables which were going down. We were having reduced surface flows, which created all kinds of supply and distribution challenges. We came up with a contingency plan where we reorganized water supply. Each place was getting a different quantity on a different day, and basically we were trying to rotate this water supply in such a way that dwindling water supply still could ensure that the distribution systems were functional and still pressurized to not ensure pollution takes over. We launched a massive program of mobile water supply to areas that were not being supplied by piped water. We were doing about 5,400 trips of water. Suddenly, you couldn't manufacture so many trucks. So we started 24/7. All institutions and all other places would be supplied at night. Residential places would be supplied during the day. All of a sudden, we had almost 60% increase in the kind of reach that we were able to do. We had these huge borewells dug. Each borewell was yielding us 1 MLD. It's not the small ones which you're normally aware of. So these were basically done in aquifers which had sufficient amount of water. Another very important measure I would like to share with you. 200 kilometers from Chennai is what is called the Neyveli lignite mines. They are coal mines. These are huge open cast pit mines, and when they go deep into the earth, you find that there's a lot of water that comes out of the coal mines. This is a hindrance to the coal mining. So all this water is pumped out into the local streams. So we felt that while we were starving for water, here was a source of water that was untapped. So we tapped this water in a very short time of 2 to 3 months and diverted it into a local water treatment plant. And lo and behold, we were able to get 55 MLD of water in 2 months with minimal investment. That was something which has been widely acclaimed, and we got some awards for that initiative also. Then we had this huge pipeline which was coming from Viranam Lake, which is about 200 kilometers. It was cast in stone that this particular infrastructure can give you only 180 MLD. We again, it is like that bumblebee, it couldn't fly, but the bee didn't know. So similarly, as MD, I didn't know that it can only supply 180. So we looked into various possibilities, did some engineering tinkering, and lo and behold, we could get another 40 MLD from there. So these kind of things we did. Then we found that a district neighboring to Chennai had a lot of agriculture wells which were basically being fed from groundwater. We went to the farmers and asked them to sell us the water from their fields, and they happily agreed. So we bought water from agriculture well fields, piped it to Chennai, and almost ensured 120 MLD of water. And this is how, year on year, we have basically been able to ensure that Chennai as a metropolis didn't have a single instance of people coming out onto the streets looking for water, or any riot or any dharna did not break out because of water lack of availability. Massive natural calamities hold for us. In terms of the response agenda for any utility, analyze and understand how, where, and how much impact any natural calamity can have. You have to optimize your existing infrastructure. Most importantly, you have to prepare for all this in anticipation. One, and rainwater harvesting has been our strength. We are also going for a big level of technology upgradation. In water bodies, we have a lot of water bodies, and these rainwater harvesting and wastewater reuse, rejuvenation of lakes is something that is going to give us a modicum of sustainable water supply. Technological interventions, we help to ensure efficiency of operations, and most importantly, to ensure that you have command and control over the entire machinery to ensure that not only it works, but also you are completely in the know-how whether it is working or not. These are
lessons learned, I think, for a drought situation and also a very high like flood situation in the city. Good experience, I'll say that, and good for all other local governments in this country or maybe other BRICS countries on that. Thank you for giving us a good presentation. We have our next speaker is a chief engineer from China Construction and Science and Technology Group, Mr. Zhu Huyan. He is graduated from Department of Mechanical Engineering from the Beijing and master's degree in engineering. Has been serving as the general engineer in China Urban Construction Design and Research Institute Company Limited. He is also a member of China Urban Environmental Sanitation Association, is an expert member of Sustainable Development Resource and Environment.
Urban water supply, sewage and sanitation have the direct bearing on the health of the people and the sustainable economical and social development, which also exert key supporting function for health development. Of urbanization. Chinese government insists on the development concept of innovation, coordination, green development, opening up and sharing, pays high attention to management of urban water supply, sewage and sanitation, regard it as important government duty and carry out a number of root works. For the water management, China now is focused on the construction of sponge cities. You know, China lack of enough water resource. The average water resource there is only about less than one-third of the world average levels. These sponge cities, that's like, some like the no effective development. So I will take more time for the, this is for the many solid waste management. You can see this is the this picture is from 1979 to 2015. The municipal solid waste removed quantity. That means last year's more than six total more than 600 cities. There are about 160 million tons. Garbage is collected, and almost 94% is treated. This waste quantity is not including the recyclable materials. For the treatment structure, you can see 60% is landfilling, 6% is simple landfilling, or dumping. Only less than 2% is by composting. The other 32% is incineration. This part is also developed fast because of China lack of enough land to landfill. In China, we like other developing countries. We have not. There's not detailed statistics about the material recycling and the informal work. In recent years, the waste energy mass balance incineration in China developed fast. In 1988, the first waste to energy facilities was built in Shenzhen, China. At that time, only two lines with the capacity is 300 tons per day. By 2015, now there are 220 waste to energy facilities was built up and in operations. The total capacity is about 210,000 tons per day, and the power capacity is 4,300 megawatt. You can see in China also try the technology or the process. Now, most waste energy facility is used the mass bond, that means use great furnace. 10 years ago, there are still some technology used fluidized bed technologies. But from the practically, mass bond with a great furnace is suitable for the garbage incinerations. So next, give you some pictures about the waste to energy facilities in China. You see, this is Wenzhou. Wenzhou cities is Shenzhen, Nanshan, and some pictures. Yes, for the different in different cities, waste to energy facilities. This is in Guangzhou cities, where the capacity is 2,250 tons per day. This is in Suzhou, Jiangsu province. It's with 8 lines. The facilities is built in three phases. This is in Shanghai, the largest cities, with 3,000 tons per day with two energy facilities. This picture you can see this is in Beijing. Lujiashan with two energy facilities is also with 3,000 tons per day. This facility is in Shenzhen, Bao'an district. The total capacity is 4,200. It's almost the largest in Asia or in the world. This is two phase. What first phase is three lines with one line 400 tons per day. The second phase is four lines with one line 750 tons per day. This is the you can see this is the flue gas treatment reached the standard of Europe. So we can the total cost is relatively low with if we compare the developed countries.
A lot of experience we required here. Most of the Indian cities are going ahead with waste to energy plants here and that. Thank you. Thanks for your presentation and keeping it in the time. We have our next speaker, Ms. Buthelezi. She is the Chief Director, Operational Policy Frameworks, National Department of Human Settlements from South Africa. She has a master's degree in social development and social policy from University of Pretoria. And she has served in the South African government since 1994 as the government of national unity led by late Dr. Nelson Mandela. She has also held a number of portfolios in the government, including serving as a statutory worker in the former Department of Welfare, which is the Social Development Department, and Department of Land Affairs, and a senior economist in the National Treasury of South Africa. She is also the Director of Support Services in Provincial Department of Human Settlements and Local Governments. Floor is yours, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you, Program Director. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. This is a topic that is very close to my colleague's heart. I've been briefed fully to be able to articulate what the message would have been for the day. I'll start by sharing with you from the perspective of human settlements where I work, to say in the country we are providing basic services. And basic services are provided by our local authorities, which is currently about 278. And what we do as the Department of Human Settlements is to provide norms and standards which we provide, which we use for the provision of water and sanitation. We'll issue what we call it a subsidy quantum to all our implementing agents so that they can be able to apply the applicable norms and standards. But the topic for today, it's basically around resilient water and sanitation management. What we'll cover, it's the rationale regarding resilient water and sanitation. And what is this resilient water and sanitation management all about? The components of the resilient water and sanitation management, and the metrics which the country currently utilizes in terms of managing water and sanitation. What is key, Program Director, is the fact that resilient water and sanitation management in urban areas is very important for our communities to survive. So building resilience in water and sanitation management in urban areas requires a paradigm shift. When we look at it, we are looking at it from a perspective of saying we know that the water in the whole world is unevenly distributed. We are told that we have 1% of water which is directly available for human needs. We have 97% of water which is available as part of seawater. we have 2% of the water that is locked up in deep aquifers. And we have a high demand for water, given the issues of the high population growth and the fact that we use the water on a daily basis for our different needs. The approach which the country is utilizing, it's in terms of resilient water and sanitation. It's around anticipation. It's around absorption of the challenges that we may run across in the event you are facing a difficult situation in terms of water, and you should be able to adapt and recover rapidly when you are experiencing drought and or you have short a supply of water in the country. What we do, it's around the utilization of the appropriate technology and infrastructure. What we'll have to do, it's around advancing our ICT equipment so that we can be able to monitor the water and sanitation distribution networks and be able to diagnose the problems. And the second strategy, it's around water storage, where we are using the current dams in terms of controlling floods, leading to the year-to-year storage. The third strategy is around the use of seawater and groundwater, where we talk about desalination. We do more or less the same things which I think India has articulated in terms of being able to intake the water from the sea and be able to screen it, filtrate, and then households. And then the other one, it's around the separation of the storm, that you'll have different residential developments where there will be residential wastewater. There will also be business wastewater in terms of the areas that we have.
The municipalities. And we have a lot of population anyway. I think maybe it's a good job for using youth to find the water leakages. And I completely agree with that. We need investment. I think that's what something happened. Thank you. Thank you for your presentation, ma'am. Chipping in at the last moment, I think. Thanks. We have our next speaker, Ms. Karuna Gopal. She is the president of Foundation for Futuristic Cities, Hyderabad in India. Futuristic Cities is a think tank influencing the urban transformation in India. She is a thought leader, columnist, and keynote speaker and advisor on the smart cities. She's also she's contributed to the design of the smart city mission in Government of India and has been invited speaker at the launch of the mission by the Prime Minister. It's a matter of pride for Futuristic Cities' central theme on co-creation has found a prominent place in the smart cities guidelines. We can stick to again.
Well, let me start with this simple slide that talks about the Millennium Development Goals and how far India has been able to achieve them. We have made reasonable progress as far as water supply is concerned, but sanitation, a lot to achieve. The water and sanitation past programs of the country, if you can see from here, right from the year 1979, the Government of India has come out with various programs and plans. So you can see the trajectory. We have achieved some places. We have learned our lessons. We are thinking of new ways of working. And the last program that you see, SBM, Swachh Bharat Mission, is perhaps the most exciting mission of the Government of India today, which has a great, great relevance in today's presentation. Well, thanks to those missions and programs, you can see a bit of a progress in the country. We see in terms of open defecation is coming down, and you see improved facilities as far as toilets is concerned, the right side, the sanitation situation. You go to the water supply, the coverage has really phenomenally increased. So we're happy to show this India trends. But this is a slide that India has to be very wary of. The economic cost to the nation by virtue of not taking care of our water supply and sanitation is almost to the tune of $100,000 million. A huge cost for a nation like India. So what India did recently was to take a deep dive. We really started understanding what could potentially be our gaps at a country level. So we looked at the local and global realities, enhancing models and softer aspects of actually driving mission programs. Well, after this analysis, we also tried to see what the world is thinking of us. So here's the risk profile for India as seen by the world. We are here in South Asia, and South Asian risks are mainly to do with urban planning, mainly to do with water crisis, and a little bit of terrorism is what we have. Unlike in other parts of the world, the risks for them are perhaps cyber attacks, it could be climate problems, but in India, pretty much water crisis and urban planning. So we went deeper into the risk profile that we have today, failure of urban planning, economy. It just doesn't have only the infectious disease, but unfortunately, India has transitioned into the non-communicable diseases as well. A health profile of India today is actually mimicking the health profile of United States that has non-communicable diseases like diabetes mellitus, blood pressure, and cancer. Very unfortunate. So today, India has a dual burden, dual health burden, infectious diseases and non-communicable diseases like diabetes mellitus, cardiovascular disease, and cancer. So all the more reason why we have to pay attention to our urban lifestyle, urban planning, dealing with a water crisis, etc. So we also did an analysis on what could potentially be causing the problem with our water supply and sanitation. So we understood our poor governance frameworks, and we launched our new mission programs. Three very, very important programs. I'm sure you heard about them yesterday too, but it's important to talk about them now because Clean India Mission is perhaps the most important mission for the country. Smart Cities Mission is another mission that infuses technology and intelligence into the urban infrastructure, and we are really trying our level best to do a good job there. The three mission programs that have been announced recently, they have gone through the rigors of research and analysis. So basically backed by science of city, as we call. Second one is the art. You know, how do we engage citizens? How do you keep them engaged? I love the presentation made by my South African colleague. Yes, that's the art of keeping your cities resilient. Third one is futuristic in outlook. So our mission programs are actually looking at innovations, technology innovations, different investment models, and individual enterprise. So when I say we did a very scientific, you know, process, we went into the depths of everything. We said, how do we give last mile connectivity if we are building a toilet? How do we connect it to the underground drainage? What is the communication is required there? What is the regulatory framework there? What kind of cost are we looking at? Can poor people pay it? So we went to IT, and India is such a diverse country with several languages and dialects. We have to reach to every audience, and we're working out the nuances of that program. It's not only that. Our programs are today it's less of conjecture, I must say, and more data-driven. So if you see the proposals for most of the cities today for urban infrastructure, you find control and command centers being at the core of infrastructure development. So obviously, we're looking at data, real-time data, sensors, smart sensors.
In our Eurasia section, we have 110 member cities from 12 countries, including Mongolia, which has joined us in 2006, and the post-Soviet countries, Ukraine, Belarus, Georgia, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, and other countries. We started our work in August of 2004. The president of UCLG, Eurasia, is the mayor of Kazan, Mr. Ilsur Metshin, who has been re-elected the president of UCLG, Eurasia, for the first time. He is also co-president of the World Organization, United Cities, and local governments, and has all legal basis and professional skills to be the next president of UCLG. For the time being, the candidacy of Ilsur Metchin has been supported by more than 5,000 cities and municipalities all over the world. In general, we try to be useful to our member cities and mostly in the practical issues. We always work on seeking best projects in the fields of transport system, provision of urban amenities, housing and public utilities, and others. And when we do find them, we try to let other member cities, especially those who have difficulties, to get acquainted with them. Our two-language bulletin, Eurasia Local Governments, is issued and sent to our member cities on a regular basis. Here I would like to dwell on the initiatives offered by our section by the president of UCLG. One of them is the stories of publications about outstanding personalities of UCLG, which we started with a legendary person, Mr. Peter Woods, who made us a great honor of coming to our Eurasia local governments. Another initiative I would like to present is the city's international activity rating. During the World Council on the 26th November 2014 in Haikou in China, the mayor of Kazan, Ilsur Metchin, presented the initiative of international activity rating. The absolute leader of the rating is the capital of Kazakhstan, Astana. As the pilot projects were successful and aroused a significant interest, we would like to put it to the world level. In July 2015, Eurasia Local Governments Congress was held in Kazan and gathered 173 participants from 93 cities and 14 countries. Not only the countries of Eurasia took part in the Congress, but local leaders from other parts of the world. The main object of the Congress was local decisions for global developments towards Eurasia integration. The Congress was aimed to capacity building and involved of local authorities in global decision-making processes. The speakers raised essential questions for progressive local leaders. Another important event of local governments of Eurasia is the agreement cooperation between different parts of the world, between different sections and different associations of local governments, because local governments must be unified and act together in order to fulfill all 17 goals of sustainable development. With a great pleasure, I would like to tell you about the latest event. In May 2016, Kazan successfully hosted UCLG Executive Bureau meeting. More than 200 representatives of 97 municipalities of the world gathered together. And this way, we also ask all the municipalities to be unified and to work together with other international organizations like BRICS and other United Nations and other organizations, because we all these problems cannot be resolved without participation of local governments, without participation of citizens themselves. Thank you.
Mr. Zuhayun. Ms. Karuna Gopal. And Rasik Sagittarius. And I request Dr. B. Chandramohan to honor our chairperson of the day, E. Mani Kumar. Thank you, sir.